So children, first, very first topic in this class 11 is the living world. So living world, and from our lower classes, we have been discussing differences between living and non-living things. And we all know that there are many differences in between living and non-living things. Like living things, they show growth, they show development, and have the ability to sense their environment. They are able to move. But there are many, and these features are not seen in non-living organisms. So we can make distinction between living and non-living things. So now onwards, we are going to study important features of living organisms. What are various important characteristics of living beings? So now we are going to discuss important features. So first is cellular structure. All organisms are made up of cells. Every living being is, we can say, a complex unit which is formed of one or more cells. If an organism is unicellular, organism has one cell only. And if there are many cells, organism is multicellular. So all living organisms have cellular organization. You must be aware of this structure, the cellular structure. What is this structure? This is, just a minute. What is this structure? This is cell membrane. I think I should select a pen which is not this much thick. Then this is, what is this? This is endoplasmic reticulum. What are these bead-like structures? Ribosomes. This is Golgi body. This is mitochondria. And then this is nucleus. And in nucleus, there is this dark body, which is called nucleolus. And this thread-like network is known as chromatin. So this specific organization is observed only in living organisms. If organisms are prokaryotic organisms, then they do not have that proper nuclear membrane. But if organism is eukaryotic organism, organism has cell membrane. So whether organism is prokaryotic or eukaryotic, there is particular cellular organization. So cellular structure is considered as the defining property of living organisms. And this cellular organization is absent in viruses. So viruses, they do not have this organization. They have only genetic material, which can be DNA or RNA. And this genetic material is enclosed in a proteinaceous coat. So they, outside a living cell, they act as non-living. And once they are inside a living cell, then they become, you know, active, and they infect a cell and they take over machinery of a living cell. So we consider viruses as a connecting link between living and non-living. Yes. Next important feature is metabolism. Metabolism is considered as the defining property of living organisms. So metabolism is, there are many chemical reactions which are taking place in a living organism. So sum total of all the chemical reactions is called metabolism. And there are different types of metabolic reactions taking place in an organism's body. These chemical reactions may be of two types, anabolism and catabolism. Anabolism is, it includes synthetic reactions. And in synthetic reactions, what happens? Energy is absorbed. Example of anabolic reaction is photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is when food is synthesized by green plants, the chlorophyll is required, and in the presence of light, energy, food is synthesized. The equation which represents photosynthesis. The equation is I hope you remember the equation. That equation is 6CO2 plus H2O. There are 12 molecules of H2O are required. And then what happens? We get a molecule, a complex molecule, which is glucose and water. 6 molecules of water are synthesized and oxygen is produced as a byproduct. So why is this reaction considered as anabolic reaction? This is anabolic reaction because simple substances like carbon dioxide and water molecules, these are used to synthesize a complex substance. This complex substance is glucose. And in this, energy is required, and this energy is provided by light. So this reaction is photosynthesis, and it is an example of anabolic reaction. Is then catabolic reaction. Catabolic reactions are the reactions in which there occurs breakdown. So what happens? A complex substance like glucose, which is represented by C6H12O6, and what happens? It is oxidized. That is why we write 6O2. And what happens? We get CO2 and water. And what happens in this reaction? Energy is released. So this is an example of a catabolic reaction. So I suppose this is clear now. Metabolism, sum total of all reactions. And there are two types of metabolic reactions, anabolic reactions and catabolic reactions. Anabolic reactions are synthetic reactions in which energy is required. And example is photosynthesis. And in catabolic reactions, which involve breakdown reactions. And in these reactions, what happens? Energy is released. Yes, children. Next important characteristic of living organisms is living organisms grow. And there are many important parameters for measuring growth. Like if there is increase in cell number, we can say an organism is growing. And because of increase in cell number, what happens? There occurs generally increase in cell mass or mass of whole, increase in mass of whole body. So if there is increase in cell number or mass of cell or mass of body, then we can say living organism is growing. And then let's discuss growth in plants and animals. In case of growth in plants, what happens? In plants, there are some specific regions which are known as meristematic regions. These meristematic regions have actively dividing cells, and because of the presence of these actively dividing cells, growth is continuous, and what happens? It occurs throughout life. So in case of plants, we can say there is open type of growth. And in case of animals, what happens? Growth is up to a certain age only. So in case of animals, we can say there is closed type of growth. So in plants, growth is continuous throughout life because of the meristematic cells. And in case of animals, growth is up to a certain age. And after this, what happens? Cells stop dividing, but yes, there occurs repair of damaged tissues. Like what happens if there is loss of blood? What happens? Normal number of blood cells is restored after some time. So what happens? We can say there is repair or healing process going on. Then growth in microorganisms. What happens in case of microorganisms? Microorganisms like bacteria, they are unicellular organisms. So what happens in case of unicellular organisms? They are unicellular, and what happens? That cell divides to form daughter cells. So we can say growth and reproduction are synonymous. So these organisms divide and form daughter cells. So these cells grow by binary fission, and growth is measured by increase in cell number only. And now let's move on to next slide. Then all living organisms reproduce. This is an important feature of living organisms. Organisms may reproduce by asexual reproduction or sexual reproduction. Asexual reproduction is the reproduction method in which generally only one parent is involved, and new organisms which are formed, they are exactly similar to parent organisms. And then sexual reproduction is the reproduction in which generally two parents are involved and there are variations. And because of these variations, sexual reproduction, we can say it helps more in evolution. And asexual reproduction is of different types, like budding takes place in hydra, and fragmentation is observed in many organisms like algae, fungi. In planaria, fragmentation is observed where body is divided, and then each body fragment is able to form new organism. And spore formation is observed in case of fungi, algae, in lower organisms. So these spores are formed in specific sac-like structures. These sac-like structures are called sporangia. And in these sporangia, spores are produced. When these sporangia rupture, then spores are released, and these spores then germinate to form new organism. And binary fission, multiple fission, these are also examples of asexual reproduction. Sexual reproduction involves generally two parents, and gametes are formed in case of sexual reproduction. So what happens when gametes are formed and then these gametes fuse? So that is responsible for mixing of paternal and maternal characters. So sexual reproduction gives rise to variations. Yes, children, consciousness is considered as the defining property of living organisms. Now, what is meant by consciousness? Consciousness is considered as the ability to sense external environment. Or we can say not only sensing external environment, but responding to changes in external environment. And the changes which happen and which cause living organisms to respond are called stimuli. So these stimuli can be physical, chemical, or biological. So what can be physical stimuli? Like touching somebody, touch, pressure. These are considered as physical stimuli. Chemical stimuli include hormones. So if there are some hormonal changes, we observe certain changes in maybe in behavior or in other functions of our body. And then these can be biological. So consciousness is considered as the defining property why plants do not have very sophisticated kind of sense organs. But yes, they respond to external factors. Like they are able to respond to light, water, temperature, or pollutants, or other organisms. So you must have heard about phototropism, which is sensing light. Stem is considered as positively phototrophic. It grows towards light. And roots are considered as negatively phototrophic because they move, they grow away from light. Plants show hydrotropism. Their roots have tendency to move towards, to grow towards water. Then photoperiod, which is duration of light, which is daily exposure to light. So that influences plants and animals. So plants require specific photoperiod for flowering. And animals also require specific photo period. In case of seasonal breeders are organisms which reproduce in a particular season. So in case of seasonal breeders, what happens? Light plays very important role. And in case of plants, flowering is affected by photo periods. And there is one point, if a patient is lying in coma and is supported by machines, so in that case, that organism is neither called living nor dead, non-living. So consciousness is considered as a defining property of living organisms.